Good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to welcome you all, those of you who are in the room and those of you who are joining us virtually for this speech today here at Queen's University Belfast, hosted by the Senator George J. Mitchell Institute for Global Peace, Security and Justice. I'm Richard English, Director of the Mitchell Institute, and it's a real privilege for me to introduce our distinguished speaker today. Louise Haigh MP is Shadow Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, was first elected to the House of Commons in 2015. In 2017, before taking on the Northern Ireland portfolio, Ms. Haigh was Shadow Policing Minister, and in that role, campaigned for the police to be properly resourced, properly staffed, and properly accountable to the public. Louise Haigh became Shadow Secretary of State for Northern Ireland in 2020. She's today going to speak to us about Northern Ireland, after which I'll ask her a couple of questions, and then there'll be an opportunity for you, both in the room and virtually, to ask Louise Haigh questions. Louise, it's wonderful to have you with us at Queen's University today. Thank you for coming. We're looking forward very much to hearing from you now, and it's a pleasure for me now to hand over to our speaker, Louise Haigh MP.
Thank you very much, Professor English, for that introduction. And can I take this opportunity to welcome you to your new post as Director of the Senator George Mitchell Institute for Global Peace, Security and Justice. I'm the first Labour woman to hold this role since the incomparable Mo Molem. You might have heard me mention that once or twice before. So I know how Richard feels about having big shoes to fill, but I know that your deep expertise and experience will stand you in very good stead at the helm of this important institute. Northern Ireland is at perhaps the most critical point since Senator Mitchell signed the Good Friday Agreement in 1998. So today I wanted to address the peace process and its current threats. I will say how I believe we should navigate those threats and outline the steps we need to take to reinvigorate the values that helped achieve peace 23 years ago. This institute is a perfect place to address these issues. The Northern Ireland peace process serves as an example for reconciliation and conflict resolution the world over. Yet while others around the world continue to learn from us, it feels like we have forgotten some of the lessons we should continue to learn at home. On the 20th anniversary of the signing of the Good Friday Agreement, Senator Mitchell reflected, "On the day that I announced the agreement, I said it was an historic achievement, which it was. But I also said on that day that by itself, the agreement did not guarantee peace, political stability, or reconciliation. There would be difficult decisions down the road for other leaders." Those words continue to ring loud and clear. Progress could never be assured simply through the passage of time. The agreement represents principles and relationships that need to be nurtured and renewed time and time again. And it feels to me that something of this has been lost in the intervening years. So the spirit of reconciliation that led to that historic agreement in 1998 must be rekindled. When difficulties arise in Northern Ireland, it has always been the role of a responsible British government to show its leadership by convening the parties and helping to rebuild bridges. We don't have a responsible government in Westminster that is capable of or interested in doing this at present. In fact, the lack of responsibility from this government towards Northern Ireland is breathtaking. But the Labour Party has always taken our responsibility seriously. It was a Labour government that helped negotiate the Belfast Agreement in 1998, and we continue to take our responsibilities and commitments to Northern Ireland seriously in opposition. So it is in the spirit of responsible leadership and our enduring commitment that I am delighted to have brought together all five main parties of the Northern Ireland Executive, alongside voices from the trade unions, women's movement, LGBTQI plus communities, business leaders, and civic society to contribute to a publication on their hopes for Northern Ireland. Many are of a new generation of politicians, leaders, and activists. Whatever their differences, many of them profound, within that collection is a collective hope for a better future and an undoubted optimism that Northern Ireland is in desperate need of today. Because these are fractious and painful times for Northern Ireland. The prolonged and deep effects of austerity have undermined public services and held back social justice. Political dysfunction has left power sharing in a fragile state. And of course, Brexit and the way it has been mishandled has been a seismic shock to the community. It has reopened old divisions of identity and belonging that the Good Friday Agreement had rendered secondary to achieving peace and prosperity. Trust in the UK government, an essential foundation of peace, has collapsed across all communities. Their reckless custody of the Good Friday Agreement has sown division and undermined stability. And this is not a partisan point, nor one that gives me any satisfaction. Peace in Northern Ireland is too precious to be a plaything of partisan politics. The Labour Party recognises and pays tribute to the work done by John Major, who helped lay the ground for the Good Friday Agreement. But we cannot ignore the damage that has been done. At the time of Good Friday, Senator George Mitchell said the most difficult obstacle to overcome is the lack of trust. It is hard won and easy to lose. Over recent years, that trust has been lost by a Conservative government more concerned in protecting its own political self-interest than acting in the national interest. Northern Ireland has become little more than an arena in which Boris Johnson can indulge in an endless public conflict with the EU to try to mask his disastrous mishandling of Brexit. And if reports are to be believed, Boris Johnson is about to take another huge risk with stability. With tension rising in Northern Ireland and a cost of living crisis across the whole of the UK, the last thing this place needs is more poisonous instability and the prospect of a damaging trade war with our nearest trading partners. Because we have seen the damage this approach is doing. It is bringing the poison of division back to Northern Ireland. Nationalists pitted against unionists, the EU against the UK, corralling people to take sides. We know the dangers of that path, and that will never be the path to a sustainable solution. That's why jobs, stability, and livelihoods in Northern Ireland depend on the EU and the UK finding a deal in the days and weeks ahead. And the voice of Northern Ireland is increasingly clear. Communities and businesses want a deal that lowers the barriers that the Prime Minister created. Communities know that invoking Article 16 would not solve these problems. It would not end this dispute or uncertainty. It would prolong and deepen them both. And it would have a chilling effect on foreign direct investment. People and businesses here are pragmatic. They want solutions, not a standoff. So the government must not ventriloquize for people and for communities who they have shown little understanding of. I have heard and understood the concerns around the protocol. Throughout all of the last year, we have been demanding solutions to lower barriers and make it easier for businesses to trade. The principle of consent that the constitutional status of Northern Ireland cannot be changed without the explicit approval of the people of Northern Ireland has not been removed. But I understand the concerns around the democratic deficit. That must be addressed and we must navigate a way forward, not in confrontation, but in partnership with the EU. Any other approach is unsustainable. That's why I've called on the UK and the EU to bring Northern Ireland's leaders and communities into the process to speak for themselves. It is simply untenable for a government in Westminster that few in Northern Ireland trust to decide the futures of communities who are excluded from the room. To say to the people of Northern Ireland, this is what we've decided, take it or leave it. Northern Ireland must be involved in these talks and in the huge decisions being made about their future. And I would say to the UK and the EU now, remember what is at stake in the days and weeks ahead. Remember what we have to lose, and remember that a deal must first and foremost be secured in the interests of the people and communities of Northern Ireland. But we have to be honest about something else too. The divisions created by Brexit and the protocol have been exacerbated because the promise of the Good Friday Agreement has not been realised, and because Northern Ireland is not a reconciled society. Crises like these, both genuine and manufactured, will continue to deepen divisions until Northern Ireland is truly reconciled. I know, and you know, that people want progress, not division. On Sunday, I was privileged to attend the premiere of Lyra, the extraordinary documentary about Lyra McKee, an extraordinary journalist who was dedicated to telling the truth about the reality of life in Northern Ireland, and who, while she was on the streets of Derry doing her job, became the 160th conflict-related murder victim since the signing of the Good Friday Agreement. Lyra wrote powerfully about the suicides of the ceasefire babies, of how the intergenerational trauma of violence had seeped into the lives and the mental health of those who had never directly experienced the conflict, of how those who should have reaped the greatest benefits from the peace were taking their own lives in a society still riven by grief. She wrote that Northern Ireland is a beautiful tragedy, strangled by the chains of its past and its present. So if we truly mean it, when we say there should be no more deaths like Lyra's, then we all face an urgent challenge to make this place work. There are no alternatives than the bedrock of peace, to share power and build a shared future. Anyone suggesting that there are viable alternatives is not being honest or realistic. No matter the future for Northern Ireland, there is no alternative than to genuinely share this place and to make it work for everyone. This will demand the courage and the leadership that our predecessors demonstrated in bucket loads. Leaders like Austin Currie, who we lost this week, who took countless risks for the sake of peace and power sharing. If we think the challenges we face now are insurmountable, let us reflect on the courage that people like Austin showed and the sacrifices they made. In the absence of that courage today, there are those who are too eager to drift towards the siren calls of populism, of boycott, and of rejection, rather than steer a much braver course on reconciliation. And such approaches will not tackle the issues that people face in their everyday lives. Unacceptable health waiting lists, insufficient school places, a housing crisis, the scourge of paramilitarism and its coercive control over entire communities, and the silent epidemic of domestic abuse. We all know that these can only be tackled hand in hand with reconciliation. But there are those who believe that now is not the time to take forward that shared future, that the unfinished work of peace is too difficult, Northern Ireland too divided, the path ahead insurmountable, that the institutions have run their course and the principle of power sharing no longer can or should apply. I profoundly disagree. In fact, the real danger, 23 years on from the Good Friday Agreement, is of going round and round in circles with one foot pinned to the floor. That is why it's now high time we bring the people back into the process. In this, I think back to the work of Mo Molan, who built relationships with community and women's groups, the grassroots. She recognised that ultimately it was the people, not the politicians, who would push things forward. That's why we must urgently establish a citizens' assembly to reach consensus on delivering the unfulfilled promise of peace, particularly on building a shared future, on reconciliation, on integrated education and housing. There is a new generation coming of age in Northern Ireland. They, like me, grew up after peace. They want the promise of a shared society that John Hume and David Trimble imagined. They want, as Lyra McKee wanted, a better life. There is overwhelming public support for integration. What we lack and what the public lack is the mechanism to drive it forward. So I believe a properly designed citizens' assembly, as outlined but not delivered in New Decade, New Approach, could be the vehicle to do this. It would be representative of the wider population by gender, age, race, and community background, properly facilitated with recommendations reached by secret ballot and the results reported to the Northern Ireland Assembly. There will, of course, be doubters, but I believe the evidence shows those doubts are misplaced. When it was trialled here, it received overwhelmingly positive feedback. 92% of those who took part agreed that their fellow participants respected what they had to say, even when their opinions differed. And 65% of people in Northern Ireland said it would be a good way to make decisions on difficult, outstanding issues. At the heart of this idea is one goal: to end the cycle of failure that has held back a shared society. I believe the people can help do that. The echoes of 1998 are there. In the months leading up to that historic agreement, Mo Molan recognised that the real division in Northern Ireland wasn't between communities, but between the many who wanted progress and the few who didn't. The same is true today. Support for the Belfast Agreement among the people remains strong. They need to be brought back into the process, a process from which they have been shut out for too long. Today's politics too often seems fractious. There is a danger that the voices of division drown out the many who want to build something positive here. In October, the great Irish poet Brendan Kennelly died. He said, "Though we live in a world that dreams of ending, that always seems about to give in, something that will not acknowledge conclusion insists that we forever begin." This moment demands that our generation begin again, matching the courage and the leadership shown by John Hume, David Trimble, and Mo Molan. It demands the British government rediscover its responsibility, put aside the politics of division, and commit to bringing people together in the interests of everyone in Northern Ireland. And it requires the people to be brought back inside once more so that we can truly build the inclusive, shared institutions that they were promised. It requires all of us to recommit ourselves and to rekindle the spirit of 1998. Thank you.
Louise, thank you very much indeed. A couple of questions from me, and then we'll move to questions from the audience. The first question is about something you mentioned there in terms of relationships. When you were talking about the peace process, you talked about the ways in which relationships made a significant difference to what could be created, and that happened at all levels, popular level, but also at high political level, John Major and Albert Reynolds, Tony Blair and Bertie Ahern. Could you say something, Louise, about now what would be the best steps forward in terms of building those more positive personal relationships which allow benign politics of the kind you're describing to move forward?
Yeah, I think that's that was clearly a huge factor in helping achieve the Good Friday Agreement, and that laid the ground, as I mentioned and as you just mentioned there, between John Major and Albert Reynolds, and the Downing Street Declaration that came ahead of the Good Friday Agreement. The personal friendship and relationship, I think, between Bertie and Tony was always apparent, and that helped navigate some very choppy waters. And I think most of those that have witnessed the current relationship or have been part of the relationship between the UK and Ireland at the moment have commented that they have not been, that relationship has not been as poor or as tested in living memory, which is a damning indictment of the way that the UK government, I think, has handled this relationship. Because success and peace and stability in Northern Ireland has always depended on a strong, positive relationship between the UK and Ireland. And in navigating the outcome of Brexit, that relationship was always going to be central to it. So I think the government should recommit itself to restoring that relationship. It won't serve any of us across any of these islands for us to enter into any kind of trade dispute. And it certainly will not serve the people and communities of Northern Ireland. At the heart of all of these discussions at the moment, particularly around Article 16, I think both sides need to consider that a deal is absolutely necessary for the people of Northern Ireland, and they should be their overwhelming priority in the coming days and weeks ahead.
Thank you. My other question is something which follows on from that, because you talked there about the people of Northern Ireland, and in your speech you referred to the voice of Northern Ireland and bringing the people back into the process. And as you said, there'll be some people who'll be doubters about a citizens' assembly. What would you say to persuade the doubters that this means of getting the popular voice involved is an essential ingredient?
Yeah, I think, you know, the Good Friday Agreement and the referendum that helped secure it was so powerful and so important because it required the people to be convinced and to be brought in. It wasn't just politicians in a dark, smoke-filled room signing agreements amongst themselves. It required the people to understand the choices that they were being asked to make, some of the sacrifices and compromises they were being asked to make. And in return, it promised that we could build a society, an economy, and a future that would benefit everyone and that would return those sacrifices. I think in the intervening years, we have lost sight of that. We have lost sight of the people being part of the process and the return that was promised for those sacrifices. And so I think it's high time that they were brought back into the process because, quite frankly, what we've been doing has not worked. We have not delivered on the promise of peace. 93% of children are still educated in segregated schools. There are more peace walls up in Belfast than there were at the time of the Good Friday Agreement. In many ways, we've gone back on reconciliation. So I think it is time that we tried something new. And I think the public are well ahead of the politicians on this issue. So I think it would be a sensible step to attempt to navigate some of these difficult issues because they are not easy. If they were, they would have been delivered a long time ago. But there is still so much more to do, and we cannot sit back and allow further passage of time as if that's going to be the solution. Clearly, 23 years on, that has not resolved the sticking points that were inherent in the agreement in 1998.
Thank you very much, Louise. I know you're now going to take questions from the guests, so I'll move on to that part of the session now.
Thank you. Yeah, we've got Gareth first. Yes.
Let me ask you about a subject that you didn't actually mention in your speech, but you could have, and that's legacy. I suppose you could also accuse the government of having stability. What do you know of
Yeah, I mean, I could have mentioned legacy. I could have mentioned any number of issues in which the government is stoking instability. We've been very clear that we are opposed to the government's potential amnesty plans for Northern Ireland for dealing with the legacy issue. Obviously, Brandon Lewis tabled his command paper back in July, and we've been expecting legislation on that imminently ever since. They've been promising their backbenchers that it would have been done well over a year ago now. So we're expecting it any day now, but we are absolutely clear that we oppose any measure that is imposed from a Westminster government on a society which few trust and which is not supported by any political party or, even more importantly, any victims group in Northern Ireland. None of those people have been properly brought into the process. And this is clearly about trying to resolve a political promise that was made in England rather than dealing with a very difficult and very complicated issue of legacy here in Northern Ireland.
So I think that any day now, so literally views about that being with us next week.
If it was next week, we won't be debating it next week, we would have seen it on the order paper, but we're expecting the legislation imminently.
That's one other question is the British government entirely culpable for the instability that this subject is causing in Northern Ireland and will cause even more? Or as well, does the EU also bear some responsibility? There was an unnamed
I think all sides should be very careful about their language and bear responsibility for the consequences they have. Clearly, there is compromise to be found. It was good to hear Lord Frost acknowledge in the House of Lords yesterday that the UK and the EU are moving towards each other on a solution, albeit he did say slowly and minutely. But that is the direction that we need to go in, and both sides need to show compromise, responsibility, and leadership. I would say, in terms of the violence that we've seen over the last week, the only people that bear responsibility for those are the individuals that are causing wanton damage. Tracy.
Hi, Tracy. Very clearly in your speech, you're saying that people will be well aware of this. Are threatening to bring up their opposition to the protocol, and that opposition is shared by all the people.
I think many understand the issues that unionism has around the protocol, and that is why we support any attempts to find solutions to that. But that is why I've repeatedly called on the UK and the EU to bring Northern Ireland's voices and elected representatives into the negotiations. We can find technical solutions to reducing the barriers down the Irish Sea that the Prime Minister created with his hard Brexit deal. And that's why I've repeatedly over the last year called for a UK-wide veterinary agreement that would get rid of the vast majority of those checks and controls. But ultimately, we do need to find a political solution. And I don't believe the UK government is currently negotiating with Northern Ireland's interests, political or otherwise, at heart. They're dreaming up new red lines that suit their own political agenda rather than Northern Ireland's interests. So it's really important that they don't ventriloquise for politicians and communities here. Northern Ireland's voice needs to be at the table in those negotiations. Well, I would say that Article 16, in first and foremost, Article 16 is not a solution. It will only prolong instability. It will not, it's just a mechanism in the protocol that will allow for further negotiation and additional time. But the government and the way that they've approached the negotiations in such bad faith and continually threatening to trigger Article 16 is clearly contributing to that instability. I would say to both sides, though, just remember what is at stake and put Northern Ireland first and foremost in the days and weeks to come. It doesn't suit any of us to be caught in the middle of a trade dispute. And I think Lord Frost and Commissioner Sefcovic should come to Belfast, convene cross-party talks and have those negotiations directly with the people of Northern Ireland. Jonathan.
Thank you. Process for my protocol Article 16 and the instability that was caused and how it's so division. What are your fears and concerns over that division and how it could play out on the
Well, I mean, I think we've seen over the last year the consequences of that division and that instability. We've seen threats for Stormont to collapse, and I think we've seen people come further apart. And whilst people have come further apart, then they've not been solving the day-to-day issues that people in Northern Ireland repeatedly tell us are their priorities coming out of the COVID pandemic, the economy, the health crisis. Whilst ever we are rowing about the protocol, and that's taking up so much bandwidth in Stormont and in Westminster, we're not dealing with those everyday priorities. I think the threats to ripping up the Good Friday Agreement institutions are incredibly worrying, and we need to ensure that those threats are off the table as quickly as possible and that we navigate those. And I do think the best way, as I say repeatedly, is to bring those representatives into the negotiations so they take some responsibility for the compromise and solutions that are found. Freya? Not here. Adam? No? Nobody else? All right, fine. Okay. Any other?
Well, you've given us much to think about, Louise. Thank you very much for coming to Queen's, coming to Belfast. Thank you for the speech. Thank you for engaging with those questions. We look forward to having you back here many times at the Mitchell Institute and at Queen's. But please join me now in thanking our speaker today, Louise Haigh, MP.
Thank you.